Case Western Reserve University's Great Thinker Series proudly presents the Origin Science Scholars Program. These lectures are presented by the Institute for the Science of Origins, a partnership of Case Western Reserve University, the Cleveland Museum of Natural History, and IdeaStream. With the assistance of Case Western Reserve University's Siegel Lifelong Learning Program, the College of Arts and Sciences, and Media Vision. Tonight, we are pleased to be here at the Tinkham-Veal University Center on the campus of Case Western Reserve University to hear Dr. Bryan Lynn speak on the standard model, the most accurate, complete, predictive, and successful scientific theory known to humans. Dr. Lynn is visiting professor of physics at Case Western Reserve University, a fellow at University College London, and a fellow of the Institute for the Science of Origins. And now it's my pleasure to welcome Dr. Lynn.
Thank you, Glenn. It's a pleasure to come here, and it's a pleasure to be part of the Origins, the idea and the program. Origins is such an interesting and relatively new concept to academia, so it's quite interesting to those of us who have never really tried particularly to communicate what it is that science does in some forum like this, as we really should be doing more of. Today I'm going to talk about the standard model of physics. The standard model is a story about the structure of matter, the dynamics of the interactions of matter. It explains what we know about the physical universe from the very, very big to the very, very small, and really everything in between. And I'm going to try to convince you that its predictive power is very, very powerful. It's a vast theory, which is based on some very simple ideas, which seem to work over some vast range of phenomena. It predicts some things to 26 decimal places. It says that this is equal to that, with all the first 26 decimal places that have been measured, and it turns out to be right. It predicts other things less accurately, but we have never yet found something where there is a prediction of the standard model and that it was wrong. We have never seen an instance in which the standard model was incorrect in something that it predicted. So that's, you know, quite impressive, I think, and maybe we'll try to elucidate what I might mean by that. Talk will be in three parts, 15 minutes each part, and I'm hoping that we can have some questions sort of in between the parts. So the first thing I'll talk about is the standard model of fundamental particles. I've added the word neutrino to the front of it because that was a recent addition to what was the standard. Recent means the last 20 years or so. It is a necessary modification of a theory that was written down in 1968, really, and essentially finished in the 70s. So the first part will be about the standard model, the neutrino standard model of fundamental particles. Fundamental particles are particles that can't be divided into other particles. They are themselves the fundamental building blocks. Next, I'll try to convince you of what I was saying before, that some very large fraction of the phenomena that we see with experiments and observation in the universe is emergent from this standard model. The third part will be about quantum loops, the quantum mechanical structure, the mathematical structure of the standard model. And that mathematical structure is itself also very predictive. And I'll try to convince you that you know, without that mathematical structure, you couldn't have predicted some very large fraction of what we have figured out have observed. So the standard model has in it some particles. We divide them into matter, which are quarks and leptons, and force carriers. The matter, you may have heard of quarks. They are the building blocks of matter. They're the building blocks of protons and neutrons. And I will talk more about that. But so far, we think there are six quarks: up quarks, down quarks, charm quarks, strange quarks, top and bottom quarks. Leptons, is a prefix which talks about light. The light particles, the leptons, are electrons, which we all kind of know about a long time. Muons, which were new in last century, and taus. So E, mus, and taus are leptons, and there are neutrinos to go with each one of those. Therefore, the electron is an electron neutrino, a muon and a muon neutrino, and a tau has a tau neutrino. So I'm going through this because although Glenn last week went through much of this, we thought that we would make each of the lectures you wouldn't need the other lecture. I'm going through this picture. The carrier of electrodynamics, the thing that makes light, is a photon. It's a carrier of electrodynamic interactions. But there are also weak interactions, radioactive decay, neutrons sitting around become protons. And that force is carried by a Z and a W. So a neutron will decay into a proton, an electron, and an antineutrino. And the carrier of that force are the W's and Z's. The strong forces, the nuclear forces, are carried by gluons. And there's the last set of forces carried by Higgs's amongst all these particles. There's this particle, the Higgs boson. Without it, we basically would have had to kill ourselves. But it was discovered, thank God, in 2012. It became absolutely necessary to have that thing, and we were desperate to discover it by about 1968. Certainly by 1972, we had no idea what we would do going forward if we didn't find that H particle. So its discovery and its the Nobel Prize that goes with it is one of the most important Nobel Prizes, I think, ever, roughly. So, why is this theory great? Well, it's famous. I don't know if that's a good enough answer. There are lots of Nobel Prizes that come up with this. I've listed, I think, 18 of them here. Before 1957, I got tired of writing down all the Nobel Prizes that are associated with what's called the Standard Model. So there's 18 starting from 1957. And 1957 is a really good year for me and my friends. So I just started there for reasons that you may or may not appreciate later. Anyway, lots of Nobel Prizes. There's more Nobel Prizes to come. As soon as neutrino mixing is understood, there will be another Nobel Prize. But I want to introduce you to someone. This is C.S. Wu, one of the great, great scientists who ever lived. She, is Chinese, but she worked at Columbia and at the Manhattan Project and various other places. But that's C.S. Wu, who is actually a friend of mine. I took nuclear physics from her, and we became pals. She was like 80 when I was 20, so we weren't that kind of pals, But she discovered experimentally that nature can distinguish between left and right. That, pointing your finger this way and doing this is different from pointing your finger and doing that. I won't go too much into it, but nature can distinguish between left and right. And she proved that in an experiment in 1954. The Nobel Prize in Physics was awarded in 1957 to T.D. Lee and C.N. Yang. These are all Columbia people. I went to Columbia in New York, and so I knew all these people. And then the question arises, how come C.S. Wu didn't get no Nobel Prize, okay? And that's an interesting question. And in fact, she was very, very, not rewarded, but recognized widely. As having contributed such an important thing that people wondered, what is this Nobel Prize thing? How come she didn't get it? She did show, though, that left-handed electrons, E lefts, are different particles than right-handed electrons. A completely different particle. And they're linked to each other, but they're completely different things. So she proved that. It's very surprising. And she, then was awarded many other prizes, including the first Wolf Prize. She was the first living person for whom an asteroid was named. She worked in the Manhattan Project, and when I was a professor at Stanford, she came to visit. And I'm going to tell you that story. The question arises why she didn't get a Nobel Prize, and I won't try to answer that question. Okay. However, She's very, very famous. And when I was at Stanford, I was a young faculty member, and the great scientist came, and I'd known her a long time. Anyway, the great scientist came to Stanford, and we all lined up, the chairman of the department and me in the back, and we, the great scientist walk in, and we're all there, and she says, "Bryan," so I'm beaming, because wow, C.S. Wu knows me. She said, "Bryan, when did you become fat?" Okay. But I thought, got a positive thing out of it. The other Stanford guys were jealous that she knew me. And I'm going to talk about the Standard Model. And it was basically invented by these guys, Steve Weinberg, Shelley Glashow, and Abdus Salam. And they received the Nobel Prize in 1979 for the vindication of that model. That's Abdus Salam. I was his postdoc and knew him really well. I'm very fond of the Standard Model. Let me just summarize the particles a little bit. Glenn did much of this, but I'd like to summarize some particles. There are electrons, muons, and taus. These are the leptons. There are neutrinos for each of those, and there are antiparticles for all of them. Okay, so here are our 12 particles, completely separate particles that need to be thought about. Anyway, there's going to be a particle zoo. There's going to be even more particles. In fact, the second one, the muon neutrino over there, second line down on the right, okay, the right entry on the left side, the muon neutrino was predicted by my thesis advisor, Gary Feinberg. He predicted this in the late 50s or so. There must, for mathematical reasons, which I won't bore you, this particle must exist. Okay, it is to be discovered. So he sent Jack Steinberger and Leon Lederman, Mel Schwartz out, to find it. They discovered it in 1962 and got the Nobel Prize in 1998 for that discovery. Okay. So Gary is here. He was my thesis advisor, and he, looks like a regular guy. And just it was the 50s and 60s. That's what people looked like in those days. Okay, but we'll come back to him a little later, just after visiting the fundamental particles here a little bit. I told you that there were three quarks to start with: UD, up, down, and strange quarks. And then Gary says, "Wait a minute, there has to be that new mu," and here's a mathematical reason, a purely mathematical reason, why that has to exist or something will go very wrong. And so we thought, oh, wait a minute, it was realized that the S, the strange quark, needs to go on this next vertical line to the right. There's the strange quark S. And because the S was put over there, there had to be a charm quark for quantum loop reasons. And we went and discovered it in 1974. The Nobel Prize was awarded to Bert Richter and Sam Ting for discovering the C particle. And then Marty Pearl discovered this tau particle. And that means for mathematical reasons, there had to be, for quantum loop reasons, see, you know more about quantum loops already, there has to be a neutrino that goes with the tau. See how this picture is beginning to look much more orderly? So then there's a B quark, because the tau neutrino had to exist, there has to be a B quark also. And that means there has to be a top quark as well. Okay. So for this set of particles, you can show they exist, that they must exist just for mathematical reasons that make the quantum structure of the theory, with the quantum loops we'll talk about, it makes them sensible. If you calculate without them, you get gibberish. You find you can't control the mathematics. You start being able to prove that 1 is equal to 2 and stuff. It just goes completely wrong. But then you are using this beautiful mathematical tool in physics, and you can straighten it all out if you just have these particles. And then the mathematics works. But then you insist that nature have these particles? Wow! That nature should obey mathematical self-consistency? That's very physics-y. It's not the kind of thing zoologists are used to. There are many, many sciences that, for which mathematics is not such a powerful tool. They've not been graced with this ultra-powerful tool. Anyway, Quantum loops is what I'm going to drag you into. It's one of the most, it's considered, you know, one of the most baroque and mathematical subjects in all of physics, and then you'll know more about it than most of the professors in some other places when you're done. Anyway, this is the list of standard model particles, okay, of matter. They have antiparticles as well, okay. But actually, the quarks come in colors as well. There's, you know, red, blue, and green, and they're antiparticles as well. And more recently, we've had to add in another line of right-handed neutrinos. So the leptons now have left-handed electrons, mus, and taus, associated left-handed neutrinos, right-handed particles, leptons, and right-handed mus. And this is the neutrino standard model, having added this last, neutrinos with rights, right-handed neutrinos, which have to exist for other mathematical reasons and important observations. This is the particle zoo. Okay, so there are the force carriers that we talked about before. There are photons. There are W plus, W minus, and Zs. They carry forces. There are 8 gluons. And then there's this Higgs thing, which I told you that we would mostly have to kill ourselves if we didn't find that. It needed to be there, and it was. Okay. Now, machines are built in order to discover things like the Higgs. This is a picture of part of the ATLAS detector. That's a person standing there inside the ATLAS detector there. And so you can see that the circuits for the magnets, which are these, you know, huge, you know, tubes that go wrap around like this, it's a big thing. And there are two things this size, ATLAS and CMS at CERN. And the Origins Group often takes people to CERN and shows them around. So if you know, we're ever interested in going to CERN, you contact Patricia or Glenn. And you may be able to get a tour. I don't know. I'm just putting him under pressure. This is part of ATLAS before it was filled in. Now, there's a central detector that goes in there where the guy is. You can't get in there anymore.
You say that some things are necessary because of the mathematics. But what is it that you're calculating with the mathematics that makes this necessary?
You write down what you think the theory is. And then you ask that its quantum mechanical picture make sense, that it not have any what are called quantum mechanical anomalies. Anomalies is a bad mathematical thing which destroys your mathematics. So an anomaly in arithmetic would be, you know, you divide it by zero somewhere. And then you got this idiotic answer, and then you got lost in the rest of the arithmetic. You no longer prove that one, is not equal to two. Okay, so quantum anomalies occur in the mathematics of the quantum field theory that we're going to do, and those destroy the self-consistency. It's like dividing by zero or something without being careful. So you wind up being able to prove idiotic things like one is equal to two. In the case of the existence of those particles, we got rid of all of the anomalous mathematical, you know, screw-ups. And the mathematics is now completely well thought out and completely obedient to any logical concepts. Like in arithmetic, where 1, 2, 3, and 4, and 5, and 6 are whole numbers, you know, you don't get worried that a million plus 2 million is not 3 million. In the case of a quantum anomaly, you'd get worried that the mathematics got itself screwed up.
Is there any room for, or even a necessity, a logical or mathematical necessity, for a graviton as the force carrier for gravity?
At the moment, we look at gravity. Okay, that's the, you know, you fall to the Earth, or stars move relative to each other, or planets go around stars. We think of gravity in two possible ways. One is that it's just a classical field. We get stuck to the Earth by this classical field. But what you're bringing up is the possibility that it itself is a quantum object, that we need to worry that the quantum structure of gravitons needs to be thought about. Okay? So one of the things in this picture is that the electron is a quantum of something. You can't have half an electron. You get one, two, three, or four, or something, but there's no half an electron, okay? So you would similarly expect that the graviton, you would quantize it. Now that mathematics is quite treacherous and a little complicated. The standard model stops short of becoming interested in that. It says gravity is just a classical force. Gravity is usually general relativity, Einstein gravity. And we're putting all these quantum particles in a background gravitational field, but the gravitational field is not itself the quantum of anything. It's just like an electromagnetic classical field, like you see in your, in electronics and so on. And it stops short of addressing the question of the quantization of gravity. We don't understand how gravity is quantized, or even if it's quantized. The standard model simply stops short of asking that question in order that it can answer all kinds of other questions and leave that question to be a separate question. So the standard model is not all the science we know from physics.
What does it mean that the quarks have colors?
It means they come in three sorts of them. And color is not what you or I think of as the color of something. It's not really red, blue, and green. It's just that the identity of two particles in quantum mechanics is a very important thing. Is this particle identical to that particle? Is it the same particle? In quantum mechanics, you really worry about that. Okay, and we say that a red up quark is not the same particle as a blue up quark. But a red up quark is the same particle as a red up quark. Okay? So we've given them another species name just so we can address the quantum mechanical question of the identity of particles. Are particles identical?
Thank you for joining us. You have been watching Dr. Bryan Lynn discussing the standard model of fundamental particles. For more information on the Origin Science Scholars Program, please visit the Institute's website at origins.case.edu. In the next part of the talk, Dr. Lynn discusses some of the familiar phenomena that emerge from the standard model, such as protons and neutrons, nuclei and atoms, inorganic and organic chemistry. Now, back to the talk.
We basically think that the fundamental particles I talked to you about, that everything that we know about is kind of made of them. Okay? I won't bore you too much about how to make protons and neutrons, but the picture of them is that there are three quarks. So I have a proton, like a baryon. Okay, baryon is just the name of a particle. And it's made of, if I can get this to work, this is an up quark. See how the arrow is going up? There's another up quark because the arrow is going like up. And here it's going, down. So up, up, down, this put together is a proton. Okay, the thing you know from nuclear physics. Okay, so we can prove this actually on the lattice. You do calculations with quarks and out emerges, a baryon, a proton emerges. From these calculations, all of the charge starts to localize into a little area and leave space-time kind of alone around it, and we can show and prove recently that protons and neutrons are made of quarks, and so are pions, and so are a bunch of other particles. In fact, this is the chart of the nucleides, and there are like 4,100 nucleides here. A nucleus would be hydrogen or helium or lithium or beryllium I won't name all of them, okay? But bismuth would be a nucleus, and it's part of this chart of the nucleides. And there are all the nucleuses that we know about, and there are like 4,100 of them. And we know how to build these out of protons and neutrons and pions. In particular, Steve, the order of 1989, used what is called chiral perturbation theory, which is the standard model, and derived the deuteron from it. Was able to show that the nucleus of the deuterium, which is a proton and a neutron stuck together into a nucleus, he derived that object and it emerged from the standard model. So when I say something emerges, I mean I can prove that if you start with the mathematics of the standard model, you'll get this thing after you work hard enough at it. So the rest of the nuclei, though, the chart of the nuclei, much of it looks like a liquid drop, like a drop of liquid, but made of protons and neutrons and pions. This was something that Werner Heisenberg talked about, liquid drops being a model of the nucleus, of nuclei. The simplest one, the smallest one, is calcium, the nucleus of calcium. It's got 20 protons, 20 neutrons, And there's Werner Heisenberg. This is 1932. Now, 1932 is, a long time ago. And for this guy to have suggested in 1932 that ordinary nuclei were liquid drops is non-trivial. Here are three liquid drops. I mean, it looks like a liquid, right? And it happens that there are three things that have, fallen into it, and there's a little jump of liquid in these three. But liquids, and he means a liquid, but made entirely of protons and neutrons. Now, you would think that since 1932, that picture would be completely wrong. But it's not, because recently it was derived, not so recently, but also about 1989, it was shown that the standard model actually admits a liquid phase, and that those liquids are liquid drops, they form into drops, and that those drops are ordinary nuclei. The easiest ones to do are calcium and lead and so on. But it's pretty good to have had a physical picture in 1932 of ordinary nuclei, since we've discovered 4,100 of them since then, and to be basically right. And all you needed was to invent the standard model and use its mathematics to derive that. So Heisenberg gets pretty good marks for me being able to derive this chart of the nuclei. Each of those little boxes is a nucleus, and it has its own properties, its charge and its baryon number, et cetera. And this is the set of things that exists roughly in our world. Everything is made of these things. Now, remember Gary. Gary was very interested in a lot of stuff. Not only did he show that the muon neutrino had to exist, he became very worried when the standard model started to come out in the 1950s that, well, if that's the standard model, what's chemistry? He means chemistry, everything, all the way materials all work. And so he decided he would derive from the standard model then, Gary would derive the periodic table of the elements, that it would emerge, that the mathematics was well thought out, but then you mess with the mathematics and out comes, all these atomic properties. And so see what a clean-cut looking guy he is? He looks really good. He was following in the footsteps of this guy, who looks a little nutty, really, because that's Mendeleev. The Mendeleev periodic table, of course, is something that people knows. No, it gives you the atomic properties, really the chemical properties of atoms. And we now know there are lots of them, Lawrencium and various things like this. These are the elements of which everything is made. And in the macroscopic world, you put these things together, and you'll get chemistry. So chemistry is just whatever this is, whatever these elements are, which now come from the standard model. Chemistry is the valence electron physics of these objects. So Gary basically decided, having derived the periodic table, let's do inorganic chemistry. So he derived what's called the polarizability of hydrogen 2. This is a molecule made of two hydrogens. And he showed that you get the right answer, experimentally the right answer, to all the decimal places that experiments could be done. So he's derived inorganic chemistry for you. It's pretty good, right? It shows that that we really are made from the standard model in a well-structured way. We can derive molecules, molecular structure, molecular interactions, maybe even derive organic chemistry, from inorganic chemistry. Like this is ammonia. Those are two different quantum states of ammonia, NH3. And there are quantum mechanical reasons I won't bore you with why the thing on the left is a completely different object, quantum mechanically, than the thing on the right. Although it looks like you just turn it upside down, it's not quite, quantum mechanics has more plans for you than that. Anyway, what about, organic chemistry, inorganic chemistry? You know, what about condensed matter and superconductors and materials? All these things can be derived from the standard model. So, in that sense, we can show that the model we're interested in has the property that no neutrino standard model prediction has ever been experimentally or observationally shown to be incorrect. There isn't a single instance in which an experiment disagrees with the standard model. There are instances in which we don't know what the standard model will predict for you. You know, we can't really derive a dog from the standard model. But you would say that a dead dog is a solution to the standard model. So on a piece of paper, I can write a piece of mathematics for you, and I can assert that a dead dog is probably a solution to that equation. A dog? I said dead dog because I don't want to become involved in religious ideas. But I'll tell you a funny story about Gary. So remember how Gary really looks much more reasonable than Mendeleev? Gary was... He was my thesis advisor, and he was interested in cryogenics. Gary thought that, you know, when you die, what you do is you freeze your body, and then you get revived by, science, 1,000 years from now, when, they figured out how to revive, dead guys, okay? And Gary would claim that it's very important to freeze your whole body, that saving money by freezing your head, okay, was not, there were cryogenics, just freeze your head because it's cheaper. See, you don't have to, all right, so the Gary's student before me, Marvin Weinstein, is in the Columbia Physics Building, okay, late at night. Gary runs down, Marvin, you gotta help me. What? We run upstairs, and Gary's got a tube with one of these guys in the tube, frozen in the tube, but the tube has gone wrong now. Somehow, it's not working anymore, the electronics isn't working. Gary's theoretical physicist has no idea what to do about it. So they run upstairs, they get, experimental physicists, he fixes it. It's all turned out fine. The body isn't going to heat up. But Marvin told Gary that, there are a lot of theoretical physics departments, but they don't have anybody frozen, okay, in the hallway, in the library, at night. There are plenty of universities that don't have that, okay? But anyway, so Gary... was an interesting man. He was a very interesting man. In all cases, I think that we'll move slightly on. I'll leave this up. No neutrino standard model prediction has ever been shown to be incorrect.
On your slide showing the nuclei, What were the black? I couldn't read the chart. What were the black?
The black ones were the stable ones, the stable nuclei to which other nuclei decay. And then the blue ones were, they lay to the left of the black. So those black decay into them. And on the right were things that decay into the black. But in the chart of the nucleides, the black were the stable ones. And when you mean stable, you mean that eventually everybody decays into iron. But you say, you talk about bismuth as stable because you have to wait, billions of years before it decays into iron.
Could you tell me if this is an accurate paraphrase? These various additional particles, if that's the word, were added as parameters in order to make things work in the mathematics. I mean, isn't this like, adding a fudge factor at some point? I mean, is it really as clean a procedure as you say?
The particles were added and they were since discovered. So. I wouldn't call them a fudge factor because the mathematics was made to work self-consistently. We demanded that these particles be eventually discovered. If they hadn't been discovered, they would be a fudge factor of some sort. But since they actually occur in nature, we don't regard them as fudge factors. In theories beyond the standard model, there are many, many new particles that explain many, many things. And so far, those are fudge factors. Until we discover supersymmetry, the mathematics of supersymmetry is unimpressive. until you discover a supersymmetric particle. It's a fudge factor. But you know, you can wait, you know, 50 years or 100 years, things change. You don't know what evolves from an idea into science. For right now, at this snapshot in time, none of those particles are fudge factors. They've all been discovered. The Higgs wasn't discovered until 2012. So it was a fudge factor until 2012. And then it was there. Thank God, it's not a fudge factor.
Does the standard model say anything about dark matter? I do know that dark matter is considered to be non-baryonic, but theory predicts collisions of these particles in space generate the same subatomic particles as normal matter. So there's got to be some kind of connection. Does the model show this in any way?
We believe it does, but you've asked, I think, an interesting question from another angle. If this theory is so successful, how come it doesn't have dark matter? Okay. But some people will say, wait a minute, this theory is so successful that there must be dark matter in it. And they'll work very hard to figure out how dark matter emerges from that theory. So if you look at the chart of the nuclides, like lead and bismuth and all these things, 100 years ago, you wouldn't really know how those things came about. You wouldn't have understood that they emerge from the standard model. So you work very hard on the standard model, and then it reveals, oh yes, I do have a chart of the nuclides in me. Or I have a periodic table in me, the standard model says. But you had to work to get it. It wasn't obvious. We expect dark matter to be like that, that we work hard and try to understand what it might be in the standard model, and the standard model will present us with a candidate. And I'll show you that, a little more about that later, about dark matter.
One clarification. You said that the between a theoretical particle and a particle that exists, does the particle physically exist?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, it does, yes. You have to go discover it, and it has to have the electric charge you think it's supposed to have. It's supposed to have the mass you think it's supposed to have. It's supposed to have all of the properties the standard model has. So you go and discover the particle, and you discover, indeed, it does have all those properties, like color and, you know, those sorts of things. Yes, so there is a huge scientific experimental program to carry out in order to establish that those particles do exist, and that has been done. And Nobel Prizes have been awarded after that.
We hope you've been enjoying the Origin Science Scholars Program with Dr. Bryan Lynn. Dr. Lynn is a former managing director in Merrill Lynch's Global Markets and Investment Banking Group. In the second part of our talk, we learned how the building blocks of materials and life emerge from the standard model of particle physics. In our final segment, Dr. Lynn will discuss how quantum mechanics is incorporated into and affects the standard model. Now, back to our talk.
So right now we're going to talk about the quantum structure a little bit. So I'm going to drag you into something called quantum field theory. And in particular, I'm going to drag you into quantum loops. Okay, these are, this is called an oblique quantum loop. It has one of these Z particles. Here's a Z particle, I think there. See this Z particle? Time goes this way, and space goes that way. So up and down, vertical is space, and horizontal is time, moving from left to right. And so a Z particle is going along. See this wavy thing? That's the Z. And it makes a top quark and an anti-top quark. The arrows tell you whether the particle is a particle or an antiparticle. Anyway, it makes a top quark and an anti-top quark. And then they recombine to make a Z. Okay? This is called an oblique one loop process. Why I named it oblique, I've since forgotten why that was, but it seemed like a good idea at the time. So everybody calls it oblique, so you can't take it back anymore. This is called an oblique one loop process. Now, this process is a quantum mechanical process. And so the way to think of it is that a decay has happened. A Z, starting on the left, a Z particle, one of the particles, has decayed into a top and an anti-top particle. But you need enough energy to make the top and the anti-top. Tops cost about 175 billion electron volts. They basically, an electron is 500,000 electron volts. These are 175 billion electron volts. So you need about 350 giga electron volts, GeV, to make a top and an antitop. You need enough energy to create the particles. If they're at rest, that's the least energy you can have to make them. And so this process, you need 350 GeV to do that. Another process could be that a top and an antitop annihilate each other and make a Z. So on the left, you start off with this quantum state over here, which is a top, you know, and an antitop. And then time goes on, they annihilate here and they make a Z. Okay? And the, you know, there's these two particles, you need, as I said, about 350 GeV. Each one weighs about 175 GeV. And you need about 350 GeV for this process to occur. Okay. Well, welcome to the weirdness of quantum mechanics. Quantum mechanics has the property that you can start with a Z, it can make a top and an antitop, and then they can annihilate really quickly. So the amount of time that goes from, you know, this Z going along, where is this thing? Oh, there it is, okay. Starting here, this creation of this pair and the annihilation here is really fast. Okay? It's so fast that quantum mechanically it's allowed. And in fact, it's allowed to happen if you only had 100 GeV. You don't have enough energy to make these particles, yet quantum mechanics knows they're there. Even though you can't make them in the laboratory, the quantum mechanics knows they're there. This is the self-consistency issues that we talked about with loops, okay? So due to the weirdness of quantum mechanics, you only need 100 GeV for a Z to be going along and remain a Z, but create a top-antitop pair. Now, that may seem a little useless, except for you calculate that diagram, set of diagrams that go with it, and you see what the influence on the properties of the Z particle are. So now you make Zs, you only have 100 GeV, you don't have no 350 that you would need to make the top. The top is too energetic for you to make it with your current accelerator. You only got 100 GeV, but it influences the dynamics of that Z, so you can figure out what its mass is. And you can predict its mass. So we predicted 173 GeV for the top quark mass in 1985. The particle was discovered in 1994. The top was discovered in 1994, which is, you know, later at Fermilab. And in 1999, Tufton and Veltman got the Nobel Prize for their mathematical self-consistency, which predicted not only the existence of the top, but eventually you could predict the mass of the top. And then you could go, when you had enough energy at Fermilab, you could make it, and it would discover it, and it came out to be the mass right where the quantum mechanics told you it had to be, okay? So this is kind of a different thing. This very heavy particle has somehow not decoupled. It hasn't gone away. If the top quark mass gets very, very heavy, if you were to imagine a theory in which it were very, very heavy, you would expect it to go away, to not influence your low energy calculations you're doing or your low energy experiments you're doing at 100 GeV. What if it weighed a million times the Z? You know, would it go away? No, it doesn't decouple. That mathematics insists that it not decouple, that it be part of the mathematical structure. And therefore, its mass was predicted. Came out to be right, just where the prediction said it would be. Now that's weird. It means that you can look for the basic structure of matter and the dynamics by doing low energy experiments where you don't have enough energy to look directly at the very heavy physics, okay, the top quark. So that's a little frightening, too. It's not just weird, it's frightening. What if I had to know the top quark 300 years ago, or let's do 150 years ago, or 100 years ago, just to measure some atomic property? What if I had to know the top quark to understand an atomic property? Okay, it would mean I could never make progress in science, because I would have to know the theory of everything before I could have a theory of anything. Right? So this non-decoupling is a very special property that has to be thought about carefully. Now, what about this Higgs particle? Okay. The Z can go along from the left, make a Z and a Higgs, and recombine to make a Z. So what happens is the Z decays to a Z and a Higgs, the particle decays to itself plus something. Can it really do that? Well, quantum mechanically can do it for a very short period of time. And so it does, and so you put the Higgs in there, you calculate the loops, and you look for the influence of these loops on the properties of this Z that you can make. You build a Z factory at CERN, and you start running it from about 1988 till about 1996 or so, and you study the Z very well, and you tease out what the Higgs mass must be from that. And the answer is this diagram here. Please neglect the right-hand side of this yellow stuff here. But given the experimental uncertainties or the experiments we had at the time, this black line here tells you what the Higgs mass must be. This is the Higgs mass down here. Is it 40 GeV or 100 GeV or 200 GeV? The prediction of what it would be, you know, with some error bars. There's a blue is an error bar, okay, you thing you didn't quite know. And this is called a probability plot. The highest probability is the Higgs is here, but it's also probable that it's, you know, between here and there, okay, and about 99% probability it's between, well, where is this thing now? Okay, it's, oh, mine's not working anymore. So you go up about halfway up, and inside that parabola, the Higgs has to be somewhere in there, okay? And so that was the quantum loop prediction. CERN looked the left-hand side of the yellow bit, looked all the way up to 114 GeV about here and didn't find it. And so we knew it existed somewhere between here and about there, about 125, 140 GeV, something like that. Or the Standard Model is wrong, and I would have had to kill myself. Others would have been very happy about it, by the way. But me, I would have to, you know, it would be bad because I've bet my life on the Standard Model, so it better turn out. So somewhere of the order 125 GeV, they go and they look, and you know what? It's there. It's there at 125 GeV. The Standard Model prediction from 1994 predicts that the mass is about 125 GeV. It's discovered in 2012, okay? Nobel Prizes are distributed in 2013 for its discovery, but we knew it was there. We predicted that it was there. And so this is a vindication of the Standard Model in a way which is very, very deep, that, you know, you really have to work hard to beat this Standard Model at anything. Okay? So the Higgs was discovered, so now we're all breathing easier. But, you know, physicists work hard at all kinds of stuff, and there are lovely mathematical theories like supersymmetry, extra dimensions, you know, these kinds of things. So an extra dimensional theory would be, you know, we have the Standard Model here in four space-time dimensions, three space dimensions, you know, this way, that way, that way, you know, and time, that's four. But at each space-time point, there are seven other dimensions right there, and an infinite number of other universes right there. Okay? So that's one approach. We don't think that's right, actually. So Starkman over here has no expectation that any of these things, global low-energy supersymmetry, technicolor, composite or Goldstone-Higgs, extra dimensions, each idea more mathematically beautiful than the previous one, right? We unfortunately believe that it's all in the minds of very smart people inventing nonsense, but don't quote me on that. We think these are aesthetic speculations. We know there's no physical evidence for any of this stuff. There's no need for any of it. Nothing has ever been observed which disagrees with the Standard Model. So we don't actually need these things. These are ideas invented in order to explain things the Standard Model doesn't bother explaining to you. It doesn't. There are parameters in it, and it doesn't try to explain why that parameter is what it is. Okay, it's just, you know, the electromagnetic coupling is 137.036, one over that, and it doesn't really try to explain that. The standard model doesn't, but these more beautiful models and larger models and greater models with many more particles in them can explain such things. Okay, and so they're very popular, and in particular, they are. For those who, for some people, they are the whole reason why the LHC at CERN should be built. Okay, so we have colleagues who say, you know, Higgs, that's trivial. Everybody knows that that's there, really. Okay. But it was there. But they say, you know, the real thing you got to do is supersymmetry, because, you know, supersymmetry absolutely, positively has to be there. Then they go to tell senators about this. And senators say, okay, well, you know, if it's not there, I'm taking money away from you. That really wasn't the right thing to do, David. Okay. So anyway, we think that that is not going to be a problem. Back to one-loop processes. I got this particle X. This is this new thing. Very heavy. It weighs, you know, like 10,000 times or 100,000 or 100 times the mass of the Higgs. This X particle, I speculate it exists. Here's an X particle, okay? And, you know, I think it's there because of low energy supersymmetry or extra dimensions or, technicolor. There are many beautiful theories. And my theory has, or not mine, their theory has some new particle X whose mass is much higher than the Higgs and can be gotten at by the LHC, the Large Hadron Collider at CERN, okay? And so they say the LHC's purpose in life is to discover my X particle, okay? And the argument they give is, again, oblique one-loop processes. Here's the Higgs going along, minding its own business, and then it decays into an X and an anti-X, okay? Here's the Higgs, going along like this to the right in time. It makes an X and an anti-X over here, okay? And then they recombine and annihilate and make a Higgs again. You know, this I'm getting better at this. And that Higgs just keeps going along. Now remember the Z that looked a lot like that? Remember how we discovered the top and the Higgs by that Z? This is a similar argument. They say that this X particle non-decouples. It doesn't go away. If you make it heavier and heavier and heavier in your theory, it will not go away. And therefore, the Higgs will know about the existence of this heavy particle. Okay? That's called the Higgs fine-tuning problem, that somehow these particles exist, and therefore there's a problem with the standard model, the purported standard model problem, which was mentioned by Lenny in 1979 and continues to the present, is that the non-decoupling of very heavy particles should affect the properties of the Higgs. And now we have a Higgs, we study the Higgs really well, we'll just learn about these particles. Okay? So that's called the Higgs fine-tuning problem. It's almost the same as a heavy particle non-decoupling problem. It doesn't go away. It doesn't decouple as it becomes very, very heavy. All right, now, whenever anybody says anything mean about the standard model, it really pisses me. I get upset about it, okay? I won't allow someone to speak about the standard model, you know, negatively in public, okay? So what we decided to do, me and Starkman, is to take the standard model completely seriously, as usual, and see, does it really have this problem? Does it actually have the problem that you would think it does? You know, if you were in your house, okay, and you were struck by lightning and died, that would be bad. But what if you weren't struck by lightning, okay, and didn't die? So there's no proof that you gotta die from lightning unless they observe such a thing. So this was a fatal disease that the standard model was supposed to have, and it would be fatal if the standard model had that disease. But once you don't have the disease, it's not fatal. So we thought we would take it completely seriously. Nevertheless, when the model is taken completely seriously, the standard, what's called the neutrino standard model, We showed that it has another mathematical property, which was, you know, a little difficult to find. It's called the Goldstone theorem, a well-known property of the standard model. The Goldstone theorem solves the Higgs fine-tuning problem. So it solves the non-decoupling problem. The Goldstone theorem is a property of the standard model. It's just that people didn't know that the Goldstone theorem could defeat the Higgs fine-tuning problem. They knew it did this, they knew it did that, they knew the other thing. What they didn't know was it also fixes the Higgs fine-tuning problem, and it fixes the non-decoupling problem, and therefore the standard model doesn't actually have a fatal disease. So it's not going to die because of the Goldstone theorem. Now, that says that we believe that if LHC runs and gets more and more energy, they will not discover anything else. There's the Higgs, which is good enough for me. But all these supersymmetry particles, all these technical particles, will not be, aren't there. Okay, so what's the possibility here? Let's do an Occam's razor kind of thing. Now, if you worry about the Higgs fine-tuning problem, a fatal problem, either a known property of the standard model solves that problem, or at each space-time point, there's an extra seven dimensions and an infinite number of universes at each space-time point. Now, which do you think is the simpler approach, right? Yeah, that's everybody in this room. Wait till you talk to theoretical physicists. They say, you know, we have extra universes, we have extra dimensions, we've got this and that and the other. I've met people who believe that it's more probable there are extra universes. What about dark matter? Dark matter is not the usual business for accelerator-based particle physics, but it is has been discovered in cosmology, and it is now a many sigma effect. It's there, and so we believe that matter, that the essentially the gravitational stuff that gravitates in the universe, that about 4% of it is the luminous matter that you see. Cosmologically, all the galaxies, all that stuff, that about 21% of it is dark matter, and about 75% of it is what's called dark energy. Now, I don't know what dark energy is, but remember that chart of the nuclides? There was a liquid phase of the standard model which became ordinary nuclei, you know, like lead and calcium, that stuff. There was a liquid phase to the standard model. So what if the liquid phase, the standard model has stuff just like that, but the liquid phase has what's called strangeness in it. Strange quarks are inside the liquid phase. All right, so you say, okay, I derived the ordinary nuclei from the standard model. I'll just put strangenesses in and do the same calculations I did that the chart of the nuclei has emerged from. And out emerges this stuff called strange chiral nucleon liquids. They're a liquid phase that has strangeness in it. So, you could have a chunk of this stuff which is a meter across and weighs, what, a small mountain or something? It weighs what a mountain weighs. It's a nuclear phase, but it has strangeness. And that could be dark matter. Who knows? Could be dark matter. Maybe it's not dark matter. Maybe dark matter is something else. But when Turner comes to you and says, there is no possibility that the standard model contains dark matter, all you've got to do is show him one possible example that the standard model can contain dark matter. Maybe the thing you're doing is not actually what dark matter is. Maybe it's a mathematical structure which has some other properties. But the way to bet is on the standard model. If the standard model were to predict dark matter, it will be there. Because the standard model, as I said before, is never wrong. That's pretty much what I wanted to talk about. This is the set of particles in the standard model. Never been wrong so far. So why isn't there a good way to bet, which is to work hard on it and see if it stands, if it solves the outstanding questions about physics that are with us? Just try to see whether the standard model solves those one by one. And that's one of the programs that we're pursuing in Origins and at Case Western in the physics department. That's what I wanted to say. Thank you.
This lecture is part of the Origins Science Scholars Program of the Institute for the Science of Origins, a partnership of Case Western Reserve University, the Cleveland Museum of Natural History, and IdeaStream. It has been brought to you with the assistance of Case Western Reserve University's College of Arts and Sciences, Siegel Lifelong Learning Program, and MediaVision. For more information on the Origin Science Scholars Program, including a full video archive, please visit the Institute's website at origins.case.edu.